Okay, I see. Well, good morning, everybody. For those of you who may not know me, my name is Pastor Thom Bauscher, and it's so glad to see all of you here in the sanctuary, and I'd like to welcome our video audience as well. We are starting to get some snow now, aren't we? I'm praying it's not going to amount to much, which I don't think it will, but I really don't have much for announcements for myself. Amy?
A few things this morning. In your bulletin, there are a lot of different things going on in the church right now. There is a summer Bible camp for Milbank kids only that's going to take place at Lake Ponset this summer. So make sure you find some information on that or talk to Christy if you have any questions. A Mother's Day project, the information is in your bulletin on that as well. This year they're going to raise some money to provide PPE for missions. There's some information about the cancer walk. This will be the last week with three services. Next Sunday, we're going to go back to two Sunday morning worship services. So there will be an 8:30 service and then an 11 o'clock service through the month of May. It looks like the last Sunday of the month that will change to summer worship hours. This will also be the last Wednesday night for a meal at the church on Wednesday, April 28th. Don't forget to take some time to sign the graduates' Bibles that are down as you come into the building. We will be recognizing our seniors Sunday, May 2nd. Now, if you will all stand and join us in our opening song, Majesty.
Majesty, worship His Majesty, unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom authority,
Jesus, be all glory, honor, and praise.
King of all kings.
Please join me responsively in our call to worship. Loving Christ, you are our gentle shepherd. We are your people. We long to know your will and to live in your way. Keep us safe and secure in your compassionate hands. Lead us, gentle shepherd. Lead us into new paths of love and service. As you lead and guide us, touch our hearts and minds in this worship time, so that our spirits may be refreshed and our lives filled with joy and praise. Please join me in our opening prayer. Here in this time of worship, O Lord, I offer myself fully to you. May your will be my guide. May your love be the pattern of my life. May your way be my hope. May your path be my help. Lord, I surrender to you my hopes, my dreams, my goals, my ambitions. I place into your loving care my family, my friends, my life, my future. Care for them with your loving care. I release into your loving care my fears and sorrows, my sense of loss, my pain and numbness, my sadness and hurt. Fill me, Lord, here and now with a deep sense of your presence and a strong sense of your empowering spirit. Take this time of prayer to renew our faith and replenish our hearts. Rebirth our spirits so that we may live with hope and confidence this day and every day. In the name of Jesus, amen. Please be seated. Just an update before we do our prayer this morning. Jolene Rick will be in the hospital for at least another week, and they are just thankful for everyone's thoughts and prayers. They can definitely feel them, but she needs our continued prayers as she's in the hospital in Sioux Falls, fighting some complications with COVID. Please bow your heads in prayer. Holy and awesome God, thank you for this day. Even though it doesn't feel like spring outside, we know that it is on the way, and with it brings new life. We pray for this planting season. We pray for safety and good weather that will bring a bountiful harvest. Loving God, help us to remember that you are with us. Whether our days are sunny or dark, whether we are experiencing good things or struggling through hard times, open our eyes to the signs that you are always with us, and let those signs bring us comfort and strength. Lord, this morning we ask for healing for Daryl Aiden, Gary Ellingson, Jolene Rick, Braden Schaefer, Nolan Foss, Shelley Welter, and Harlan Bone. We know that there are others that are in need of your healing touch, and we lift all of those unspoken names to you now. Lord, we all have needs and praises, and you know every single one. Help us to remember that you are with us no matter where we are at and what we are feeling. We are thankful that you meet us right where we are at. Be with us, Lord, as we worship today. We know the Holy Spirit is here with us, and we pray that we see the Holy Spirit move in each of our lives. Now hear us as we pray the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand and join us in our song of worship, Lord, I Need You.
Lord, I come, I confess.
bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you.
Be seated. Our scripture this morning comes from John 10, 11 through 18. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father.
I'd like to invite the children to come up for a few minutes. Oh, we got one boy coming.
One boy.
Okay. All right. You guys know the story of the three little pigs?
Yeah.
Okay. You want to help me out with something this morning?
Yeah.
Okay. I need half of your verse. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So can I get three of you to come over here? Just three. Okay. One more over here in this group. Okay. Okay. You gonna help me out? No, you want to come over here? Thank you. Okay. Now we got four on each side. Okay, this is what we're going to do. I'm going to read. I'm not going to do the whole story, but I'm going to read the story of the three little pigs. And this side, every time I say the word pig, I want you to oink. You guys, every time I say the word wolf, I want you to howl. Okay? Can you guys do that? Okay. Now, I was thinking as I was sitting there a few minutes ago, should we have the adults help?
Yeah.
Should we? Okay. How about then you guys stand up here and face those people. You stand up here and face those people. You over here, every time I say wolf, you're going to howl. Okay? You over here, you're going to oink every time I say pig, okay? And they're gonna help you out, okay? You guys are going to help them, right? Okay, you guys ready? I'm going to share the story. Here we go. Okay, this story begins with Mother Pig. Okay, sending her three little ones out into the world. The first little pig built himself a house of straw. The second little pig built a house of sticks. And the third little pig, wow, you guys are good, built a house of bricks. The big bad wolf, nice. You're harmonizing there. Okay. I went to the first little pig's house and knocked on the door. Little pig? Little pig? Let me in. The little pig answered, not by the hair on my chinny chin chin. Then I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house in, said the wolf. The first little pig's house of straw was not very strong, so the wolf easily blew it down, and the little pig ran to the safety of the second little pig's house. The wolf went to the second little pig's house and knocked on the door. Little pig? Little pig? Let me in. Little pig, the little pig, answered, not by the hair of my chinny chin chin. Then I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house in, said the wolf. Oh, they kicked it up a notch there at the end, didn't they? Wow, you guys did awesome. We'll be done with that. Have a seat. Thank you guys for, yes. Yeah, that was great. Wow, I was really impressed with all of you. It was nice having them help out, but you guys did an awesome job. They had a lot of oinks, didn't they?
Yes.
Yes. So the howl, the wolves had to pick it up a little bit, didn't they?
Yeah, so that's when we did.
Yep, you did it. So here's what I want to share with you. Jesus says he's the good shepherd. And as a good shepherd, Jesus protects us from things like wolves, okay? And wolves can be anything, though, really, right? Because there's bad things that happen. There's scary things that happen, right? But ultimately, Jesus is going to protect us, or at least he's going to help us go through those things. And he'll never leave us alone because he cares for you and he loves you, okay? All right, let's pray. Loving God, we thank you for today. I thank you so much for these children, and we thank you for the good shepherd, Jesus, who cares for us so much that he'll never, ever, ever leave us alone. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Okay. Ladies first. Oh, I could have done the one gentleman, I guess.
Oh, well.
Oh, well.
Nothing.
Go ahead, buddy. Okay. Oh, actually. All right. What kind of car does a very rich shepherd drive? a Lamborghini. Hey, did you hear Chad laughing over here, Ian? Yes. He was great. Yeah, thank you. All right. That's going in the wind column. That's what I heard. All right. So I'm going to start by asking a question. I'm not expecting an answer yet. I just want to give you the question now, because here in a little bit, I will ask this question again. And I want to give you a little time to think about the question, because I do want to hear what you have to say this morning, okay? So here's the question. Who or what intentionally or unintentionally misleads us and draws us away from the Good Shepherd? Who or what intentionally or unintentionally misleads us and draws us away from the Good Shepherd? Could be anything, right? Okay. Now, in our gospel passage this morning, Jesus says, "I am the Good Shepherd." Now, we know from almost the very beginning of Scripture, all the way through Scripture, that sheep and shepherds are a very common heritage. It's a very common thing in their culture. People would have known if they weren't shepherds, they knew people were shepherds. So those kind of analogies and those storylines were very beneficial for the people throughout biblical history. In the Old Testament, we hear some of that with Abraham, right? He's known as the father of Israel. He was a shepherd. Moses tended his father-in-law's sheep. David was a shepherd. We also have Psalm 23. It's known as the Shepherd's Psalm because it starts out with, "The Lord is my shepherd." And there's Isaiah, who spoke of the coming Messiah when he said, "He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather his lambs into his arms." Old Testament continues on into the New Testament. We probably recall the parable of the 100 sheep, one got lost, right? And then the Gospel of Mark, we hear Jesus saying, "They are as a sheep without a shepherd." It goes on and on and on. The Bible is overflowing with unique and rich symbolism of sheep and shepherds. In fact, I would risk and say that the sheep and shepherd theme is probably one of the biggest themes throughout all of Scripture. This morning's scripture is also unique. It's unique in that, again, Jesus calls himself the Good Shepherd. That's the unique piece of this passage. Jesus says, "I am the Good Shepherd." Now, when you hear the word good, let me tell you this. When I hear Good Shepherd, I think, good? What's that? That's fair. That's a C, you know? Why isn't it Great Shepherd? Jesus is the Great Shepherd. He isn't just the Good Shepherd, right? And this is one of those passages where it's important to do a little study, a word study, because when we look at the word good from the original Greek, it has a lot stronger meaning to it than what we would consider the word good to mean. And when we do that, what we find is that the word really should be translated to something of the effect of a model, or true, or honest. All of those words are connected with the word good when we're referring to the Good Shepherd. So now it's not just a C, average, whatever, right? When we think of the Good Shepherd in that language, it also means this is our model, this Good Shepherd is trustworthy and honest. A little more significant, isn't it? Just knowing that one word being translated to its full extent. Jesus is the Good Shepherd. He is a Good Shepherd who truly and honestly knows his sheep, who sincerely cares for his sheep, who is willing to lay down his life for his sheep, unlike a hired hand. This is what it means to call Jesus the Good Shepherd. Honest, trustworthy, willing to lay his life down for the sheep. Now, I have to tell you, there's some couple of implications here, things being implied here, that if we know a little background, have some significance in this scripture too. The first is this: if Jesus is the good shepherd, then that must mean we're his sheep, right? What's a good shepherd without sheep? So we're his sheep. And like sheep, we need, I love that was a perfect song to pick, Lord, I need you, right? Because we need Jesus. We need his kind of care for us. We need his kind of love for us. We need him just like a good shepherd. We need him to protect us in the only way that he can protect us. And we need someone to have our interests, our best interests in mind. And if we are the sheep then, if we are sheep, and Jesus is our good shepherd, then our relationship with him should be a relationship of dependence on him. I'm also implying something when I say that, right? I'm implying that we don't just depend on ourselves, which we tend to do. Sheep depend on their shepherd. We need Jesus. Left to our own devices, we can easily meander around. We can find ourselves lost. We can find ourselves alone. We can find ourselves scared, even misled, and maybe even taken advantage of because of some of the false shepherds that are out there. We need the good shepherd, and we should find our dependence on him. Okay, Jesus is the shepherd, we're his sheep. The second implication is this: if Jesus is the good shepherd, then that must mean that there are some not so good shepherds out there, right? Which in this case, in this context of the scripture, Jesus is actually saying something about the Pharisees in particular, but the religious leaders in general, that they've been not so good sheep. The truth is that God had entrusted these Pharisees and these others to be the good shepherds of his people. Now, I know we give the Pharisees a bad name oftentimes, and it seems like we dog them a lot. And I know I've shared this before in the past, but the reality is Judaism wouldn't have survived without the Pharisees, so we need to give them some credit. But by the time Jesus came around, they had become corrupt. And the Pharisees were more concerned with themselves, and they had very selfish motives. They weren't concerned about the people like God intended them to be concerned about the people. And in many ways, they unintentionally at least misled some of God's sheep. Okay, now with that, here comes the question. I'm going to rephrase it a little bit, okay? Now we know these implications. We know a little bit about the word good. If we think of not so good shepherds as anyone or anything that misleads us and draws us away from the good shepherd, who or what might those things be? What are those things in our lives today that we see that draw us away from Jesus? Let's hear it. Open up the floor. Cell phone. Yeah. Yeah. Does anybody spend an hour or more on their cell phone in a given week? Yeah, you laugh, right? You laugh. Right, right, exactly. But even an hour a week could have been time we could have been spending in God's Word, doing a devotion, right?
I do puzzles.
Puzzles? Yep. Now, that's a good example, Ian. And the reason why I'm going to say that's a good example is because that's a hobby. And there's nothing wrong with hobbies. Inherently, there's nothing wrong with puzzles. But if they drive a wedge between our relationship with Jesus Christ, then they are an issue, right? Because if we're spending 15 hours a day on puzzles, Well, we probably need therapy then, but you know what I'm saying. There's nothing wrong with somebody going fishing. I'm going to talk about that and a little bit later. As long as it doesn't drive a wedge in between my growing and in my relationship with Jesus. What else you guys got? TV. So, of course, my wife would say that one because the example I used in the other two services were the TV one when somebody brought it up, because this is what I said to everybody else, so I feel like I have to say it to all of you, is that instead of me spending a couple hours of watching literally meaningless TV, right? Because most of it's meaningless TV. Why am I not spending time doing a devotional with my wife and kids? Or spending time praying with my wife? Because my wife's sleeping. Yeah, that's give her a blanket and that recliner. She's out. Yeah. Oh, I could tell you I've been praying. You would never know the difference. But truthfully, right? What else? What's that? Daily chores. Now, sometimes daily chores need to be done, right? There are certain things that have to get done. But at the same time, if you're creating chores that don't need to be there, then you have to wonder. I know there's more out there. Say what? Satan? That's Olivia, right on the money, right? Satan's out there trying to drive a wedge in our relationship with Jesus, right? Trying to push us away. And Satan uses a lot of the things we were just talking about as a means to do that. What else? Steve? People, yes. Yep. People who may think they have good intentions even, right, in our lives. Yep, and uses people nefariously in our lives, right? People. Yes. Work? Who said work? Amy said work. You know, and that's a good one. You know why? Because we honestly believe that work is essential, right? But I'm just going to be real with you guys and just say it straight. There's things like work that we think we need to do only because of our standard of a living, right? The reality is sometimes maybe we don't need to work as much as we need to work, which goes back to materialism, which was mentioned in last service as one of the things, materialism. Deb knows that's one I've been working on for a long time. What else? This is good stuff. This is good for all of us.
Everyday life.
You want to explain a little bit more on that, Ian? Oh, yes. Yeah, so time, right? How we prioritize our time, maybe? Would that work? Yeah, how we prioritize our time. That's good. Worry. Yeah, that's great. Yeah, how much of our energy do we spend and waste on worrying instead of simply trusting in Jesus? So, Grandma Jan just said that killing herself doing stuff for others, Right? At what point does sharing our gifts and our ministry become a burden and a hassle, right? When does it become self-defeating? We've talked about this in the office. You know what? We need to be, say, focused on ministry and being in ministry and not thinking of it as a job or work. Because once we go down that road, or if you're a yes person, you're always saying yes to everything, you're going to get burnt out. What else? What's that? Telling ourselves we're okay. Yes. Yeah. I think if I'm hearing you right, you're saying justifying. Yeah, I was going to talk a little more about that one. That was the one I referred to over here. But it's right. There's so many things we justify and say it's actually okay. My hobbies are a good example of that, right? Materialism is an example of that. Social media and our telephones, all the things we've talked about, we make excuses and justify it, right? I'm not saying anything you guys don't know, right? I'm basically saying the common knowledge thing. But what about this one? This is the one that that gets under my skin a little bit. And it's the one that's been progressively getting to be more and more and more. And it's been around for a little while, but it's about you syndrome, right? Turn on the TV, at least every other commercial saying it's about me. It's about me. It's about you. It should be about you. The reality is, and this is the title of the book that I want to write someday. The title of the book I want to write is called, It's Not About Me. Because if we really want to be honest with ourselves, we have to acknowledge the fact that it's not about me. Once we do that, the issue of time, the issue of social media, the issue, every issue that's mentioned starts going by the wayside. Others. Oh, politics. Yeah, politics were mentioned in the last two services too. That's right. Yeah, politics. That can really do a number, right? Yep. What's that, Lonnie? Sports. Sports. Yep. Hate to admit it, right? I hate to admit it. I do. But I can easily justify watching 9 hours of football Sunday with myself. I can justify that. Man, how many books of the Bible I could have gotten read in that period of time? How much studying I could have done? How much ministry could I have accomplished? The truth is that we live in a world where we have a lot of different kinds of shepherds that are calling at us. Shepherds that come in the form of people, of thoughts, of ideals, of beliefs. Shepherds that claim to be good and sometimes may have good intentions. We have shepherds that vie for our time. Shepherds that intentionally or unintentionally mislead and draw us away from the joy of our relationship with Jesus Christ and the security that we have in his love. You know, no matter who they are or how diverse they may be, these false shepherds, these not so good shepherds, all fall so very short of our good shepherd. Because our good shepherd does know our basic needs. Our good shepherd knows our need for guidance, our need for security, our need for compassion, our need for peace, our need for forgiveness. He even knows all of our traits. He knows our feelings. He knows every single thought we ever have. He knows every action we take. He knows every single detail about us, whether it's good or whether it's not so good. And he still loves us. And he still loves us so much that he did, as a good shepherd, lay down his life for us. This is who our good shepherd is. There's no other shepherd that can come close to comparing to him. And we need our good shepherd. Maybe more now than ever. Now, if you don't get anything out of today's message, I really want you to hear this final thought that I have. It is so important that when we're going through and doing life, that we're intentional, that we're deliberate at identifying those things that are or have or potentially could lead us astray. Because at the end of the day, you guys, at the end of the day, it's only the trustworthy shepherd. It's only Jesus Christ, only him alone, who has the power and who has the authority to save us. Amen? All right, let's bow our heads in prayer. God, we thank you for this day, and we thank you so much for your son, and really the privilege and honor to be able to call him our good shepherd, knowing full well what it means to call him good. Lord, we do have a lot, as you know, that vies for our time, for our resources, for us, things that intentionally and unintentionally create this barrier, this wedge, or whatever we want to call it, between us and your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, I'd pray that we'd all have eyes to see and identify those things in our lives and not justify it to ourselves, but instead truly own it, even though it may cause us a little heartburn or maybe make us feel not so good about ourselves. We need to hear it. We need to hear it. Because we do know that we are the sheep and that our dependency and our salvation lie with our good shepherd. We pray all this in his name. Amen. Let's just take a brief moment and reflect on the message and scripture and the conversation today. Okay, let's stand and join in our song of centering our God. Yes.
into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome and power. Our God, our God, our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome and power. Our God, our
awesome in power, our God.
God is stronger.
God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power, our God. Our
amen, amen. That was a great song to end with today. As Steve pointed out, I think one of the hardest things we have to do is overcome justifying those things in our lives that create that barrier, that wedge in our relationship with Jesus Christ. Because our relationship with Jesus Christ isn't just supposed to be stagnant either, right? We should be actually growing in our relationship with Jesus Christ. So that's our challenge, right? Is to overcome that first obstacle to be able to truly identify those things. So may God's peace go with you, and God bless you, and we'll see you guys next week.